Hello, Music Multiverse listeners. Welcome to another Album Review Saturday show. This is episode 5. Album Review Saturdays here on Beyond Your Radio. Well, they're an extension of the article section in the video version here. I will review the original 3 that I talked about on the article section, but also add in 3 more reviews. And like today and last week, I'm going to be joined by a panelist, and D.A.H.M. is with us, so that's fantastic. She was intrigued by the albums in the list, so I'm always welcoming the panelists to join, although I know it can be all-consuming. So, as always with us at Beyond Your Radio, any genre, any style, just a friendly reminder, if you have not subscribed yet, hopefully this is the video where you succumb to our musical charms. We love to have you as a regular. If you have subscribed, thank you. You know you always have a seat here at our last dinner party. All right, here's the 3 albums I reviewed on the site. But remember, Deb's here, so she's got her take too. So no fast forwarding. Nara Jarreau's Polaroid Lovers. We've got the last dinner party, Prelude to Ecstasy, and all the way from Spain, Cheddar. Psyche. Cheddar. We'll get to that.
Cheddar.
And yes, today we have 3 additional reviews at the end, which we'll reveal soon. So let's talk Sarah Jarreau, who's no stranger to the music multiverse. Sarah's voice is effortless, enrapturing, and familiar, no matter what landscape of musicianship she tenders to be surrounded by. Most in the past, she's an alternative folk, country folk, bluegrass, fiery Americana, we'll call it. So chameleon of sorts. You will realize it right away. You probably heard her voice before. After all, she's won a few Grammys. But what you might not realize right away is that she's floating warmly in this soft jazz vocal style throughout a contemporary musicianship, subtle country, and the swing soft rock. So this accomplishment puts her in some unique status with the likes of Jan Arden, Nico Case, to just name a couple that would come to mind immediately. Polaroid Lovers is just one of those lovely albums that doesn't have a solitary song flaw for me, unless you might be taken aback by the fact that the bluegrass and the alternative country have been heavily diffused. Now, I know there's people out there that will be, she's selling out. Okay, whatever. I don't agree with that. This is a well-crafted and intentionally arranged snapshot that features all kinds of life-capturing moments, and that are the way it is now, or at least for the songwriter that she is matured to. So let's listen to The Way It Is Now, snippet of it, if they'll allow it. I think it might get blocked. Who knows?
Heart so heavy, I forget to breathe. Determining the future, like anyone knows what's around the bend. I can stand still, I can change like the wind. This is the way it is.
The risk you take every week.
Yes. This album has reflective commentary followed by beautiful areas where the artistry of the instruments get to subtly shine. And this song does encapsulate that pretty well. So on that note, and I'll let Deb come in on this because, my opinion is merely one of many.
Well, on this one in particular, I agree with everything that you said. It's beautiful from the start to finish. It is so easy to listen to. It is something that is like a ethereal type feeling, like you're just out there in the clouds listening to her. I know that she, I think, plays mandolin normally. I did hear a little bit of mandolin on this, but even though she kind of moved away from what her roots are, you could still hear the influence in it for sure. You can tell that she's Texas girl, but without the twangy type of country that we think of. But she never really was twangy, in my opinion. I like folk, and I like that kind of twist on things. And she always did her alternative stuff. It kind of melded it all together. It was an interesting take on how she would perform her music. But that being said, if you didn't know her, you might not catch the things that I caught as far as what her background is. You might think totally different of it, but I bet everybody would think it was beautiful, whether you know anything about her or not. Definitely listen to the lyrics. These aren't words just thrown against music. It's intentional, is what, definitely intentional. And if I was doing an album review, album challenge or something, or one of those where we have to score everything, my overall score, I know you don't like this, but a 4.5.
4.5. Well, you'll love it.
I'm late to the partial point system because I listen and I follow the rules, Mark, but on this one, 4.5.
Okay. Yeah, this album for me, there's picking, right? But there's also strumming and playing, right?
Yes.
And it's important where the differences are in the songs and the flow of it. And I think that's the gorgeous part of it that tells me there's no sellout there. That's just, it's great songwriting beyond the lyric. You know, the lyrics kind of ensnare this thing, right? If Columbus in 89th, which is a song on the record, is an actual place, which I'm sure it is, this album and Sarah's impeccable delivery is beckoning us to join her in that moment in our own lives. Those places of significance in our own Polaroid of love and life. It's a wonderful singer-songwriter love letter to explore from the vocal to the lyrics and into the depths and the importance of the instrumentation and compositions that are with it. That's the overall experience. So at the end, well, not at the end, I think it made somewhere in it. She asks, am I good at what I do? I think the song kind of, right?
Yeah.
Well, isn't that something we all hope for validation somehow in all that we do? So to you, Mr. Rose, who's blocking this maybe because of a record company, in the music multiverse, I can assure you that you certainly are doing this well, and this is an outstanding proof of it. And we'll eventually sit right about there when the record comes in. There she is, right there.
Is that your S's or your J's? How is
that's
your
my J's,
system?
And I know what it better. Listen, it better be thin because it ain't going to fit in there unless I got to move all that shit around.
Yeah, you got a lot of organizing to do.
Hey, that could take a week. All right, so we move on to the unexpected, the unknown in this realm for me, and that would be the last dinner party. Now, mind you, I was cordially invited to listen to this. Okay, everybody was, because it says you're cordially invited to listen. So I guess I wasn't that special, but when I saw that, I thought I was. So from the orchestra-bounding, foreboding movie soundtrack fashion beginning, we feel the level of cordial invitation and the anticipation of what we don't know what's to come. The music kind of goes either way, and you're like, oh, geez, we're all going to get murdered at this party? Possibly, I don't know. But so we sit down at the table surrounded by the music multiverse with our headphones on, and it begins. Burn Alive starts, and the vocal hits you. Immediately identify PJ Harvey and Florence Welch of Florence and the Machine. Now, these are not the people in the band. I didn't look it up, but I kind of had this feeling like, did one of them join the band? Is this a super group of sorts? No, these are just a super talented bunch of ladies from London. But that kind of puts you on notice that ecstasy is, oh, many things. Good, bad, and different. And so it goes. And dinner is served. So Prelude to Ecstasy has a lot of intriguing. It's got bombastic and harmonic moments, leaving your ears in true ecstasy. I guess that's the idea. If you're open to the unscripted opportunities of art pop, art rock, indie rock, alternative rock, and orchestral crescendos, which this has, that leave you absolutely breathless in cases. Oh, and this is definitely giving you the feminine urge, with Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking album sides. So we'll listen to Feminine Urge.
I am a dark red liver stretched out.
The vocals, while captivatingly surrounded by ever-changing musician landscape, from tickling pianos to orchestral booms, are truly the ecstasy of the record. To the ear that holds that cover barely on, let me tell you, it's seductive from start to finish. As a male listener, I'm drawn into their pleasure-seeking palate, ears perked, excitingly awaiting the next level of song. Kind of voyeuristic. If I could find the audio term for it, I'd give it to you. But hell yes. It's also lovely and tender too, where it's intended to be, although I feel it's brief in most cases. Like the what, On Your Side, I think was kind of on the mellower side. You know, indie rock for me sometimes gets a boring rap in my ears. Indie usually means independently produced and a somewhat stripped down approach to the overall rock way an album is processed. Admittingly raw, and sometimes, at least United States, it's guided by the area, the country they're in. Like if you think about Oregon, they have that, you know, oh, it's indie rock. Well, is it? Or is it just placid and they just don't really want to do a record deal kind of thing? They want to just produce it in a barn out back. So I believe here these ladies understand what to do. The album is produced intentfully to do such a thing. To bring indie to me is something you haven't heard before. It's independent of the sounds of today. It melds other sounds from the past or today, but it doesn't go, oh, look, I'm this. I'm like this person. I'm like that person. So, and that is at the helm of James Ellis Ford, who produced this record. He loves Pleasure and Pain, I think. Depeche Mode's Memento Mori, Arctic Monkeys' The Car. And of course, the aforementioned Florence and the Machine records. He understands the true meaning and glory of indie rock, I think. Definitely has done that album to album. So that's my take, but let's hear what Deb had because I don't think she knew the band either.
No, I did know the band, but I didn't know that I knew the band. How, let's put it
There
that
you
way.
go.
Okay. All right. And
Yep.
if anybody watches this show and listens to my commentary on things, they know that I'm not very schooled in the vocabulary that you have, the definitions that you have surrounding different kinds of music. Even though I understand what you're talking about, but that's just not how I process music. I just listen to it as more of an organic thing. I don't dissect it. I don't even remember names of songs, even from my very favorite band in the world. I don't know. I can sing their songs or hum, should I say, but I don't know the names and I don't remember
Right.
which albums they come
Huh.
from. But this album was the one I started with, actually, when I was listening. And I was intrigued by the album cover. So if we were doing that, I would give that a five. Love it. It
Ooh.
would make me go, what's this all about? Is that the band? Because you can't tell from the name that those ladies are the ones for, doing the album. But so I turned it on, and the first song is all, it's all orchestral, right? It's there's no words in the first song, right?
Nope, it's
So
basically the opening of a movie, you know, you
yeah,
would think.
exactly, just like you said. And I'm going, oh my gosh, is he really making me listen to a whole album today with no words? Not that I remember the words or whatever, but I was pleasant. It was beautiful, but I thought, oh, is there's going to be 12 songs like this? Well, no. The second one totally erases that trepidation I had. But that second song is where I went, wait a minute, copied a song from the radio that I know. And of course, I don't know the name of the song. I don't know the name of the band that does it. But then about what, nine songs in, eight songs in, there it is. And I went, they didn't copy it. They wrote it. And that's why I recognize the vocals, just the whole, you know, collaboration between all of them, the instruments they're playing, and also what they're trying to deliver. And that is Nothing Matters. As we pointed out in our pre-discussion, Mark, it is the explicit version. So yes. Maybe that's why I don't really pay too much attention to words, because when I listen on the radio, that isn't what the artist intended. It wasn't that offensive, but I'm a grown adult. I wouldn't let my 8-year-old read the words on the screen, but
yeah. Yeah. It shouldn't be on Kiss 98.5 in your morning drive.
And that kind of leads us back to what the name of the album is. Prelude to Ecstasy. So there's a lot going on there with feelings, and it's not all sexual at all. I didn't take it as sexual. I just take it as moods, and there were sexual things, but I would listen to this album over and over again. I loved it. So my score is a 4.75.
Oh my gosh. I thought you were going to go to the five all the way. What will it take, woman?
It might become a five if I listen to it a second time.
I guess it's no Peter Gabriel, I.O., but
it's not.
Although there's a lot of instrumentation here. Mandolin, uh-huh. flute, guitar. Uh-huh. I think two of them play the flute, actually. Bass guitar,
oh, really?
Keyboard, organ, piano, synthesizer. Yeah.
You know what's so good about that? And that's what I was going to mention about the Sarah Jarosz one as well. It all blends together really well, but unless you're listening for something specifically, it doesn't stick out to you. It just is what music is supposed to be. It's supposed to be one big story where you're taking voices. A voice is an instrument. And when you've got, it's produced well, because I don't hear anything that you go, that's a little too forward there, but love it.
Yeah, the last dinner party was the experience of the year so far from start to finish. I'm stuffed. I'm bloated. And tripping over every moment in the memory, attempting to savor the moment again. Oh, wait a minute. Thank God. It's an album. So I can just overindulge and put the needle back on and do it all again. Unbutton my pants, consume more. Wait a minute. That didn't come out right. Don't miss Prelude to Ecstasy. It's killer. And these ladies are astoundingly good at serving it all up in glorious indulgence. Nothing matters, right? Now, except you getting this in your ear and trying to outlast them. Good fucking luck.
Yeah.
Cheddar. Psyche. Cheddar. On Twitter, the guy says, you got to hear Cheddar. Really? Cheddar. I can't even, like, if you name your band Cheddar, I can't even come to an exact conclusion of what you're going to sound like.
What's your band's name?
Yeah, that's your band name, Cheddar. Yeah. So what are you cheesy? So that's what I was expecting. A whole lot of cheese. Maybe some hair metal. I don't know, right? So let's immediately address the beloved band name here. There is nothing cheesy about this band or this album. In fact, grab a glass of the most decadent red blend you can afford and allow this poorly named Spanish quintet to take you into the modern, moderate occult hard rock sound that is Psyche. Yes, that's right. The title track is merely an intro piece that has chirping birds, a hint of keyboard. I don't know why, because none of them play the keyboard, apparently, in the band. And the words of someone you believe to be speaking on behalf of the struggle of human nature and the oncoming evil. Oh, no! Then the progressive entry of acoustic guitar and the elegant entry of the noteworthy Clara Doransoro. Now, if I butchered her name, I apologize, but her vocals, her name should just be called Wow, okay? And then the bass, the drum, electric guitar seeps in like shadows, and we're off. Brilliantly off. It's riff, booming, soaring vocals. They rise and swallow. The full opening track is Chrysalis, one, making sure the hook is set and your ears are locked. And then Chrysalis 2 and Lamort and Imago 2 and Limerence. So let me give this to Deb, and then I'm going to go into my suppositions of this tragic name.
Well, I was completely surprised by what I was hearing based on the name of the band and the name of the album. Okay. I purposely didn't research any of these bands first. I just wanted to listen and get my own take on it. Definitely the keyboard was something that reminded me of progressive rock of my youth. But female, yes, or female, but not anything that bombastic, not anything so stage crazy, more subtle, but definitely reminded me of progressive rock that I like. And I found it interesting the names of the songs because that's, a butterfly coming to life and opening up and flying off into this beautiful as this beautiful creature. Which I felt like this album did. I felt different stages of it. I felt that it was a metaphor. I don't think it's psych. I think it's psyche.
Okay.
That's what I think. Which makes sense because your psyche, as you grow and morph into a different person or a growing person, maybe not a different person, but an evolving person, which, butterflies do. I would like to go back and listen to this album again with that thought in mind because it didn't come to me until the end where I went, oh, I think this is kind of where they're going. And I was shocked by the name of the album and the name of the group that they were females. When it started, I thought, well, did they just have a female singing? It's beautiful. Beautiful.
Female singer surrounded by talented.
And I enjoyed that one too. Do you want the album cover? I'm not gonna get
Oh,
that's
it's
what is
terrible.
ha it's
No idea.
horrible. What is happening? Like my cat could do
I thought
that.
maybe, you know what I think that is? I think that's the cover of the album cover to protect it from whatever, in so you don't get it
Crinkly.
dirty. Yeah, no, it's like a cover, like you did your books in school back when you and I went. Don't have books now, but because
Your
no one reads.
books.
But anyway, yeah,
Yeah.
no one
So,
reads them. Why am I writing stuff online? I don't know.
well, what I'm going to give this album is just a 4, and it has nothing to do with the album cover. It's just that I do need to listen to it more. I don't know much about this band, but how long have they been around? Or do you
They
know?
have been around conceptually designing this record 3 years. This is number
Really?
one. Yeah, so debut. Both debut.
Well, wow. Okay. That's all
Oh
that
yeah,
needs
this
to
one
be said.
especially. This one especially. I mean this, right? I
Okay.
mean, don't get me
Well,
wrong, this is sort of this is you haven't heard this.
yes.
This you kind of heard in other places.
Yeah, of course.
Evanescence, right? So but still damn good debut, right? And well, that's you should be able to put out a damn good record if you're Canadian, but these aren't Canadian, so I don't know.
So, well, that was my take. I'm interested to hear more from them in the future. How's that?
Yeah, I'm hoping it doesn't take 3 years to make an album, but I under okay. So here's Psyche. I like that because I was in on the Psyche part on and definition-wise. This is an odd play, and I don't know if this is intended by psychological metaphor and butterfly hit my windshield. And this is where I took this. So, Psyche is a melded album of progressive metal without keyboard. It has a keyboard at the beginning for some reason, and they replace that with guitar people, two guitarists who just wail and do whatever they want to do, which is utterly fantastic. So, it's a cult style hard blues rock. Progressive, you can't say because the keyboard's gone, so it's not progressive rock, although it's in a progressive nature because it has a wonderful flow and ebb to it. So I called the guitaring beguiling and dueling at certain
Ooh,
points.
wow,
Ooh, yeah,
yes.
only because it sounded right. It's probably pure bullshit, but anyway, allowing
Sorry.
the strength,
You and your
it
thesaurus.
sounded so good, allows the tracks to fall into the next. So it's creating like a seamless experience as you listen to the record. So, but the ethereal vocal can belt, she can whisper,
Yeah.
and it engaged cleverly within the crushing riffs or the surprising beefy bass line like that of Lamort, which we'll listen to right now. That'll allow us to play shit and
Love
challenge the
cheddar.
captivating, yeah, and
My
challenge
favorite
the
cheese.
captivating. Yeah.
Sorry.
There's often dark drumming in here, which is kind of a snarly in every inch of it. You want to psychoanalyze this band? Do you want to go ahead? Okay. Do you dare? Careful with Cheddar. Careful. All right. By the time it's into the ripping, oh, it's into Imago one. I'm starting to become aware of just how self-aware this band actually is. Okay, this is my take. Not like Deb's, a little bit different. They have this band name for some reason, and I'm starting to think that unconscious, idealized mental image of someone is exactly why. By the time I'm into ripping through this record, Cheddar, how enticing cheese is in its power. Okay, and its connection to many things,
Oh,
right?
stop.
Oh, Cheddar, it's so indulgent, right? The faults of human nature. And now this limerence, that's the one, is bellowing in my ears, all beautiful and progressively dark, right? Well, yikes, look it up, people. It's a state of infatuation or obsession with another person that involves an all-consuming passion and intrusive thoughts. Set the headphones down. Step slowly away from the chatter. Oh, but it's so damn good. She sounds so beautiful. The music is amazingly hard, bluesy metal. It's calling to me again. Those dark grooves, that hypnotic vocal play. It's calling the dangerous nature of musical conception to be played again and again. It's chatter. I've never wanted anything so much. I agree with the statement on Bandcamp. Dive into Psyche, fear and wonder. A struggle against the shadow that lurks among the collective sum of our minds. Yes, what they said. It's all about that board of cheddar.
Well, step away from the nacho cheese dip, okay?
Yes.
Because we all want that, but we know it's bad for us. There you
You went down a butterfly thing. I went to
go.
like,
Wow,
Jesus
that
Christ.
is good. That's the male versus female. That's what's so
See,
intriguing.
that's yes.
But I like yours. Yours is actually more fun.
Well, I tried to make it entertaining. We are here
That's
to
great.
ascertain you, in the words of Gord Downie.
Ascertain you.
First up on this additional review for your YouTube, for our YouTube audience who hopefully didn't fast forward to this, we're going to start with Ty Siegel and Three Bells. I'm a longtime fan of Ty and his sonic creative process and indulgences, sometimes overindulgences. And once again, he goes all in. I don't think he ever doesn't. Reaching for a new audio color to paint and deliver in, utilizing a bit of groove. And in this case, I thought Beck like texture to bring you maybe a little closer to the sonic wheelhouse and love for all kinds of intriguing and interesting guitar work and patterns that he does. But obviously, not the Beck of the guitar, Beck the, groovy loser. Fame. As always with Ty record, the vocals tend to get picked up secondary. They're sort of raw. The sonic nature of his sound and signature is always there. So I'm going to play Eggmen for a particular reason.
Hey.
This is a lot of fun. And while he may be sort of a 2024 punk reimagining, a follow-up to the Beatles' I Am the Walrus, it's probably not. But damn it, it does have that feel. I mean, he's a Beatles lover. Don't get me wrong, because he's got that jangle. He's got, you know, but he's modernized everything. He is experimenting as always. And I think the distortion and concepts are clever. It's dripping with metaphor and finger pointing and post pop punk. It's a glorious album for fans of Ty, I think, but I think it's a hint more accessible for those to come, because usually much of his stuff is noise rock and somewhat intolerant to certain ears. So Three Bells is a great way to get into Ty if you're a novice, for sure. So being that I know that Deb is a novice, what does the novice say?
Well, actually, I probably would have enjoyed this album more if I listened to your review first. You did text me something that maybe put something into my head that influenced what I was listening to when you said Sonic, Beck. I love Beck. I've always loved him before other people loved him. I just found him very innovative, intriguing. So that's what I was actually listening for, which is not good for me, because then that's what I'm critiquing it on. And that's, I'd rather just go in blind. And that's why I did on these other ones. It was nothing that I went, oh, I have to listen to this again. But now that your review, I will listen to it again. I wish that I had heard other things by him, so that, because if I probably wouldn't like him. Do you think his other works, like me, knowing me the way you know me?
A while back, I mean, there are some times where I enjoy a noise rock album that just defies logical explanation, and they just throw it down and say, you know what? What does the song mean? It means nothing. We just got up there and we thought this was crazy funny and fun, and we just went with it. And he did that with a thing, I think it was called Taste. And it was in my top albums of that year. There's Dinosaur Jr. They've done this kind of thing. I don't think that's right. Is it Dinosaur Jr.? That's not right. That's not the name of the band.
But I like that.
Shoot. No, that's, is that the, it's Dinosaur something. Actually, Alex brought the album up in one of the things. Really? I'm like, how do you know that album? He goes, oh, I love that album. I'm like, yeah, it's a noise rock. The Eye Flies is another one that I enjoy. Tub of Lard is the name of the album. When you name your album Tub of Lard, you know that you're not going down this, you know, it ain't Bjork's Tub of Lard, all right? This is somebody's real bad Tub of Lard. And it's just engaging. I put it out in my car, and if somebody else was in the car, they probably would jump out. You know?
Yeah, so that I would
yeah,
go
yeah, definitely
back
one of more, his more accessible records, for sure.
Perfect.
Okay. So, let's get back to the ladies. Strangely enough, with Lucifer.
Crazy.
This is their fifth album, and honestly, this is the first one I've ever listened to. I know they've been
really?
Talked about on other channels, especially Sea of Tranquility, and I always like, oh, I got to listen to that, but I just never got around to it. So again, this is band name. This is definitely hard rock. It's, for me, it's 70s Kiss style, if you ask me. Let's listen to The Dead Don't Speak. And this is well done 70s guitar hard rock with a typical female rock vocal and flow. For me, the songwriting falls in line with their band name, but it's very light occultish feel here. I don't feel threatened at all. I feel like, you know, afterwards they're probably going to Chateau Les Amis to have dinner. You know, they don't think they believe a word they're muttering, which, you know, I'll let you enjoy the tempo surprises, because there are things in here in this album that they are unique, which kind of makes them a bit more modern than the late era I'm speaking of Kiss. But that's in that wheelhouse of when you first hear it, you're like, okay, this is, you know. But Deb, what do you think?
Well, my first thought was the female Motley Crue. That's what I thought.
Okay.
Within like three notes. I can name that band they're copying in three notes. That's not how I felt about the entire album at all.
No.
But I kept going back and kind of feeling that that might be what their influences are. I don't know anything about the band, so I don't know what their training is. I don't know, where are they from? Lucifer, did you just say? I didn't.
No, I did not. And that escapes me at the moment, but go ahead, keep
That's
doing
okay.
your thing. I'll
so
that word.
I enjoyed it because I'm not a hair band person, but I'm now at a point in my life that I appreciate a lot of different things in music that maybe I didn't while they were occurring.
Germany.
Germany. Okay. Yeah, Germans love Lucifer and evil dark spirits, but I don't know why,
well,
but they do.
Step away from the microphone, back away, get to Starbucks, you know, have a happy moment. Is there a Starbucks in Berlin?
But
yeah, it's right next to the wall.
I did enjoy them. I did think, oh, I want to know more about this band. I'm assuming they've never had any hits that on US stations or anything playable on the radio. But
if it is, it'll be on like Headbangers Ball, maybe. And I don't know.
True.
You know, that doesn't really exist anymore.
Does that exist? Headbangers
no,
Ball?
No. I know that guy is probably doing something. I mean, it's still, for me, I was hoping, because metal's had a resurgence. The stoner rock definitely has.
Yes.
And fuzz rock, we'll call it, or psychedelic rock, maybe not the psych of the 70s, but psychedelic rock now. But this is their fifth, right? No, whatever. I don't want to go back because I don't think this is any
different.
Like, if you wanted to go back and see where the progression, right? I kind of think, like, I don't
they're
know.
They're stuck.
And
this
maybe,
is what this
maybe,
is their
I just
game.
It doesn't intrigue me. It didn't intrigue me to go back. I'm sorry to say that. But I mean, the problem is too, I just listened to this woman's vocal.
Yep. Yeah,
right?
True.
And these
that,
ladies harmonically.
Yeah, you had a lot
bingo,
of ladies in the mix.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah. And if I'm going to go back and listen to, you
You'd
know,
listen
well,
to
these don't
one of
have
them.
any debut
Agree.
Or other albums, but yeah. So.
Agree. I mean, it wasn't off-putting. It wasn't, there was nothing that I went, I don't want to listen to more of these
right.
songs. It was just, there was nothing that actually stood out as new or is going to grasp me into going, I'm going to put away my Motley Crue for you. Not that I have Motley Crue, but you know what I mean?
For me, I guess my one was like, I was every, the minute I heard this, the I don't know how many songs in a row, I'm like, I'm thinking Creatures of the Night by Kiss.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's some songs on there that I'm like, oh yeah, basic beat that Amoeba can keep time to. But then there's that song like, oh man, they're crushing it there, right? And that's this, they're crushing it here. There's some little tricks of the trade
potential
that they, yeah. So
potential if they can see beyond what is here today. If you're saying that there are other albums and this is kind of like nothing is. There is no chrysalis in this. There is no evolution. There is no metamorphosis. It's them. And that's what kills the hair band rock, the hair bands, right?
I picture them opening for Sleep Token. And when they open, that Sleep Token comes out and eats them and devours them. And then they're gone.
Yeah, I'm afraid of Sleep Token. So I digress. Back to you, host.
all right. So now that we've gone all these routes, why don't we go back in time? Let's get back to 90s alternative pop. The UK, you know, that feeling's been missing, you know, that feeling, right? So finally, it's the return of EMF. But to be honest with you, even though the sound of this album doesn't depart from anywhere near where they were 30 years ago, it's kind of the same. It feels fresh because of the overall content that's dominating us here beyond your radio. You know, I like the pop rock, the claps, the upbeat tempo, and the unbelievable way they're able to deliver it. They, for me, are recapturing the essence of them and the era. And it's so far, for me, it's okay. I'm not sure what the generations beneath me. Well, not that they're, but, you know, not beneath me. Although if they don't pick it up, they will be. This is no progressive baby boomer is going to like this shit. There's no way, you know. The yes people are not going to be lined up at buying tickets for EMF. Here's Reach for the Lasers, which has a bit of Madonna's Vogue in it, I think.
Oh,
One of the
yes.
songs jabs at TikTok. You've got it's jabbing at generations. It's cool. It's high energy. The Beauty in the Chaos is a pop club rock record with the EMF signature all over it. And it's kind of a refreshing reminder of a fleeting era that had its hits and fun. I don't think this album is going to save us, but it definitely is a nice change of pace from a band from the past. What say you, Deb?
Well, I was. As always, I don't remember who writes songs, who produces songs, who records songs. So when I searched this album on my limited music availability of Amazon Music and, oh, am I going to get in trouble for saying that? Or YouTube, I typed the band in and the first song that comes up is Unbelievable. And I went, wait a minute, they copied this song from that song from a long time ago. That is terrible. Mark, why are we listening to this album when they're just stealing stuff? I didn't know they wrote it. I didn't know they were 30 years old. I thought they were a new band, which is good because then when I listened to the album, I thought that it was relevant to today, even though it was sounding what like what was familiar to me 30 years ago. But not off-putting, not like they're robbing a generation. You know how sometimes people are just revisiting, bell-bottom jeans and different things where you're just trying to reinvent what already happened because you have no imagination. I didn't feel that from this album. I felt like they're just good at what they do. And it sounds good and it's pleasant and it's fun. I had nothing bad to say about it other than this just proves I should not be on this show. Because I don't know that was their song. And Mark keeps asking me back. And so here I am with my stupid way I say things, but I liked it. I really did. I enjoyed it. It was fun. It was, I guess I wouldn't like go, oh, this is going to be a band that we're going to be talking about in 50 years. It's nothing like that. It's just
Well, it's a band we talk about
sometimes.
in 30 years on this channel, anyway.
Stop. I won't be alive, but you know what I mean. It was good. I liked it, and I'm not going to rate that because I don't know.
Right. No, it's
I enjoyed it.
So I want to thank Dam for joining me so that you didn't just have to hear my banter for 15 to 25 minutes. It leaves a fresh perspective, and obviously the reason I do this channel is for individuals like Deb, like the Grateful Dude, like many of you maybe out there, like, why isn't he reviewing all these bands that everybody knows? Because you already know them,
Right.
right? Because what I mean, don't get me wrong, I still review some of them because they're intriguing too, and they're on a path of change and but yeah, it's all about that. So tomorrow is Unknown Sunday, and featuring a jazz blues legend that might be unknown as to his importance and discography to some. We're on the web at beyondyourradio.com, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, articles, videos, and podcasts. All about music, albums, artists, and bands. Go beyond your radio with us, a real music appreciation channel. Until tomorrow, I guess. Happy listening.
Bye.